Resistive RAM or ReRAM is an interesting technology that people have been looking at from a non-volatile perspective. There's an implementation called PCMO ReRAM, which is much different. And Peter, could you tell us what in the world is PCMO ReRAM?
Well, thanks, Bill, for asking. So, anyway, first, thanks for having me on here, and hello to your audience. PCMO is a different type of ReRAM. It all belongs to the same class in terms of being resistive, in terms of having a high resistive state and a low resistive state being the set and the reset conditions. But it's there's basically two different ways of doing it. Now, most of the ReRAM out there is called filamentary, in that they're actually forming these wires or filaments through the PCMO material and then making and breaking that wire, which gives it its high and low resistive states. That works well, but it takes a lot of energy. It's relatively slow, and that is a physically taxing mechanism, so the endurance of those cells tends to be pretty compromised. PCMO is the other way. So PCMO is a crystalline structure made up of four different elements called praseodymium, calcium, manganese, and oxygen, in a very specific kind of a crystal structure called a perovskite, which is similar to a piezoelectric kind of a structure as well. It's not piezo, but it's similar in that because of that crystal structure, it supports an electronic conduction when the oxygen is in that lattice structure. This also has the property of that oxygen being somewhat mobile, so that you can have that the oxygen being pulled out of the crystal structure and then re-injected back into those vacancies. And that's the presence or absence of the oxygen is what gives us that high and low resistive state. This is also something called an area RAM or area ReRAM, in that instead of just having these little filaments, it's the entire area of the cell which is involved in this oxygen migration. So because of that complete area usage, the actual current into the cell is spread out over the area. So it's much more of a gentle process, I guess you can say. And that gives us two things. One is it's very, very fast, because that is a single pulse response to the electrical pulse on the cell. And secondly, the endurance is much higher, because you don't have these wires basically that you're driving through or creating through this material. That's really what we differentiate as. It's a scalable process. It gives us very high bandwidth or very fast speeds, much higher endurance, especially when compared to other typical emerging memory technologies like NAND flash or PCRAM or the filamentary.
Okay. Well, I'd like to talk about applications in a bit, but first, let's talk a little bit about the configuration that you have available to designers, because the persistence, the endurance, the speed, the amount of power are all variables. It's not as if you have one static design. And how do all of these compare with DRAM and flash? Because they're sort of at the opposite end of the spectrum.
They are, for sure. So one of the things that we've been pleased with is that, as I said before, the speed of the response of our cell is very, very fast. So we are operating, we are writing and reading at faster than DRAM speeds within that DRAM window. So there's no latency, there's no speed penalty for having our memory being used side by side to the DRAM or along that either CPU or GPU core processor. You don't have the latency penalties that you have with other kinds of technologies that are out there. The other thing is that our process actually gets better as you scale it down. And we're at 60 nanometer cell right now. We work with IMEC over in Belgium in terms of doing our technology development. And we're going to 20 nanometers this year. So 20 nanometers will give us basically the same speeds, but it'll reduce the energy consumption because that scales with area. We expect the endurance may actually improve. We'll see how it turns out. But definitely 20 nanometer cells will give us, that's always been our target in terms of the cell size, in order to get us to the densities that are going to be interesting for these different types of applications, definitely in the gigabit level scales. that will be of interest to these types of applications that are out there.
Okay. Now, in terms of persistence, you can actually adjust it in terms of the overall design from, say, hours to days or months.
Yes, that's
as
right.
Compared to something like flash, which, you know, is designed for years.
That's right. Yeah. So that's one of the it's one of the features of our different technology. There's different ways that it can be used. So for sure. I mean, you can it depends on the different types of applications. You know, if it's a data backup for a database, you know, caching kind of application, you know, maybe you don't need that data to be, you know, persistent for months, right? Maybe it's you know, hours is enough, right? In which case you gain by having much longer endurance. Just like with any technology, you know, the harder you program it, you do give up some in terms of endurance. But even at the most extreme, you know, we're still better than flash and other, you know, other emerging technologies out there in terms of the endurance of our cell, just because of the nature of how it switches. Because you have this ability to have tunable persistence, then in an embedded type of application, you can actually map different sections of the memory on the same chip. So you can have a high retention area and a high speed, you know, high endurance area, all on the same chip using the same technology. And that can be managed dynamically by the, you know, by the processor, you know, as an embedded solution.
That's very interesting. Now, you were talking before about some of the applications. Let's talk about some of the ones where we're talking about AI, for example. How does that map? Would you essentially have the DRAM out there for certain calculations and this RAM as essentially storing the weights, for example?
You know, the weights are used in the processors, you know, in doing those inference engines calculations. Right now, those use primarily SRAM because it's the fastest thing that are out there, right? So we're not saying that we're going to replace the SRAM, but we're saying that we could be a backup to it or an intermediate cache, if you will, of all of those values. As these clusters are getting bigger and bigger, you know, one of the concerns is that, you know, if there's any kind of a fault, system fault, then to bring the entire cluster back online means you have to reload all of these billions of weights, you know, parameter weights. Of course, they have long-term storage, whether it's through SSDs or CXL or some of these technologies. But having something that is immediately available to that CPU core and that can be written to and read from basically at DRAM speeds, we think can help them with a much faster system recovery.
It sounds like being able to refresh this, say, on an hourly or daily basis or something like that would be sufficient. I assume that's also going to be providing this at a more efficient, from a power perspective, as compared to DRAM.
Yeah, so if you're using DRAM for either database storage or weight storage on data that really is basically static, then, you know, DRAM has to refresh constantly. So you are expending all that extra energy just to keep this kind of static information, just because it needs to be accessible fast and you need to write to it very fast. So giving them a persistent solution that can work at the same speeds, but, you know, only what would need to be refreshed once an hour or once a day, depending on what the application needs, of course, would dramatically reduce the overall energy consumption of that memory solution. So memory is, you know, when you look at, you know, there's a lot of discussion going on about power consumption because of these AI engines that are out there. I think we're all seeing that. And for sure, I mean, the biggest power is still going to be the GPU processor and just moving data back and forth. But every little bit counts. So being able to have a persistent solution that can lower that energy, you know, wherever you can get it. I mean, we need to help to contribute to the solution.
In terms of implementing this, you're going to be licensing it. How does this work with the standard CMOS process? And have you been working with any foundries on this?
So we work with IMEC in Belgium for our technology development. We've also worked with Stanford. So we have experience in doing the fab transfer from one fab to the other. Everything has been designed from the start in order to be as easy to integrate and transferable as possible. So everything that we use, everything that we do use is standard fab equipment. Everything, all the materials that we use are what we call foundry safe.
Mm-hmm.
The actual cell itself is inserted between metal lines. So it's a back end of line integration that's fairly easy and fairly low cost and still can give the, you know, the density advantages that that the foundries are going to need. So anyway, we're well positioned to work with any foundry on any advanced CMOS logic node in terms of introducing this memory technology to them.
Okay, well, great. Just before we close, can you tell us a little bit about the company? How long has it been around?
Company actually has been around since 2007. It's been working with IMEC, and also we have an alliance with Western Digital in terms of developing and analyzing this memory for as a potential emerging memory solution since I think 2014 timeframe, something around there. So it's you know, a lot of people may not be familiar with 4DS, but we actually have been around for quite a while, and making quite a sustained investment in this technology in order to really bring it to the market. So 4DS really is the only company that has been able to bring PCMO, you know, to this state of development on an advanced CMOS node.
Well, great, Peter. Thanks for filling us in on the latest technology in RE RAM.